I didn't exactly have the same high school experience as everyone else did. I didn't go to public school, or military academy, or do any kind of vocational training. Instead, I joined a cult. Or, in other words, I went to a Christian fundamentalist high school. Now, not to be confused with non-denominational Christianity or a Catholic school, fundamentalism is where you get a lot more of the radical groups. They're the type of people that sit on the street corners with their picket signs screaming, "Fire and damnation on you all," because you decided to wear the wrong piece of clothing that day. That's fundamentalism. And I have to be honest, despite how awful going to a school run by these people might sound, I have to admit it wasn't an entirely negative experience. I made a lot of great friends who were on the religiously moderate side. I played several leading roles in theater. I played tennis. There were really a lot of net positives to it, but there was always this underlying religious aspect that permeated the entire culture that more often than not hindered my experience rather than help it. Now, I should let it be known, I'm not at all against the study of religion. I think you have the right to believe and practice whatever you want, but the version of Christianity that they were teaching ranged from logically questionable to morally quite objectionable. I remember one time in particular. I was in an Old Testament Bible study class. I'll let you figure out what the subject matter in that one was. And we had just finished reading the story of Moses leading the Israelites out of Egypt in captivity. This prompted the teacher to tell us what freedom meant in the biblical context. She did this with a specific analogy. She pulled out a fishbowl with a little toy fish inside it, sat it on the counter and said, "Class, that's freedom." Well, when most of the class, myself included, were visibly quite perplexed by this analogy, she went on to elaborate a little bit further. She said that in this analogy, we were the fish. The bowl itself are the rules and restrictions placed forth on us by God. Things like don't swear, wear the proper clothing, things like that. And the space inside the fishbowl, that's freedom. In essence, we were allowed to do whatever we wanted as long as it conformed to the rules and restrictions placed forth on us by God. And just like a fish out of water, should we ever leave these boundaries, we die. Now, fun fact, there are currently around 500 million people on this planet that identify themselves as atheists who are happy, healthy, and for all intents and purposes, alive. And they might have a contention with this sermon. But I too had my own contention. Because what this idea boiled down to is that we were free to live in confinement, which, beyond being a blatant oxymoron, is visibly false. And not a single person was asking questions about this. So, I did the smartest thing that you can do when you're surrounded by radical ideologues. I asked questions. I threw my hand up and I said, "Mrs. O'Donnell, how are you going to explain to me that freedom is the same thing as confinement? How does that even work?" Well, I don't know if any of you have seen images of Mount St. Helens erupting, but the reaction I got was quite similar. We started arguing back and forth and point after point. She would ask a tough question, I would respond in kind. I would ask a tough question, she would respond in kind. It was a big disagreement. So big, in fact, that when she realized that there was no convincing me of this idea, she called in the headmaster to come talk to me. This was now serious. Not only was this the head of the entire school that she was calling in, this was also her husband. If there was anyone on school grounds with the right and authority to not entertain questions and simply tell me to shut up, it was him. And that's exactly what happened. He declared that, "William, there's no morality that can be found outside of the Bible. These rules are for your own good, and I will hear no more of it." So that was that. It was by no means the last contention I had with the material, but at this point I was worried that if I tried anything like that again, I might be expelled. But this argument kept ringing in my ears. Here I am, almost 10 years after this situation, still arguing with my teacher in my head. What was it about this disagreement that bothered me so much? Was it the fact that I was silenced by the administration? The fact that no one was asking a question about it? The pure absurdity of the argument itself? Well, maybe. It could have been one or all of those things, if I'm being perfectly honest. But the one thing that might explain it happened to be the one thing I was most afraid of. What if she was right? Now, I don't mean, what if people start dying because they don't follow the Bible? What I mean is there a definition of freedom that actually fits this mold? And I thought about it. I thought about it for a while, actually. And sure enough, I think I found one. It's the Constitution of the United States. Now, on its surface, it's the foundational document of our governing body, but what does that mean to any of us? We, as Americans, have an issue where we're so culturally isolated from the rest of the world that we often forget just how unique our form of government actually is. Before our country's founding in 1776, the main forms of government out there were things like monarchy, oligarchy, theocracy, tyranny, in essence, all of it. Essentially, one person or several people would gather together and decide what is good and what the law would be, and you as the citizen simply had to obey it. You as the citizen then were allowed to do whatever you wanted as long as it conformed to the rules and restrictions placed forth on you by your monarch. And should you ever leave these boundaries, you die. Does it sound familiar? It's exactly like the fishbowl. Well, that's what's so unique about the Constitution. It does the exact opposite. Think about the Bill of Rights. The First Amendment promises the right to freedom of speech, practice of religion, and gathering of public protests for every citizen. That doesn't sound like a rule placed forth on the people. What about the Second Amendment? That states that in the name of self-defense and resistance to tyranny, all citizens are allowed to bear arms. What sort of government would allow for a rule like that? The Third Amendment states that in times of peace and war, no soldier is allowed to take quarters in a citizen's household. Well, by that logic, it would seem that the people have more power than the government. What about the Fourth Amendment that states that no government official can perform an unlawful search or seizure? Are you noticing a pattern? Do you see what I'm getting at? The whole Constitution and Bill of Rights is an example of this, but the bottom line is, the Constitution is not the law. It is not a set of rules and restrictions placed forth on the people. It is a set of rules and restrictions placed forth on the government so that they cannot enact a tyrannical will, thus ensuring freedom. The government is the one in the fishbowl. The Constitution and the Bill of Rights are the bowl itself. And should the government ever leave these boundaries, democracy and the democratic republic that we live in as we know it is what dies. And in its place, tyranny is what arises. When I came to this conclusion, I was consumed by an overwhelming sense of peace. My teacher, she was right, in a roundabout sort of way, and I felt that I could finally let this argument I had with her all those years ago go to rest. And it's because of the Constitution that I will never know what kind of hardships that I've avoided in my life. But you can see it every day reading the news. Whether it be women in the Middle East, or protesters in Hong Kong. These are people that are starving, willing to give their very lives for the same freedoms and rights that we take so often for granted. Well, I for one am not going to take mine for granted. And neither should you.